And welcome to Emmanuel High Church for a time of worship from wherever you might be for a time of worship this morning. Today is Sunday, November 17th, and it's the 25th Sunday after Pentecost. Before we get started, here are our morning announcements. Tonight, we do have confirmation, so I will see all the confirmands and mentors back here in the CIC room at 5:30 this evening. And then we'll have a missions meeting this week on Wednesday, the 20th at 7. It will be via Zoom. So that's a rescheduled meeting for all of our mission members. We'll have one more lunch and learn this week. We are still doing Understanding the Old Testament. And our next video is Paul's Theology on Slavery, which should be very, very interesting. So I hope all of you that have a free hour at noon on Thursday will stop in and learn just a little bit more about the New Testament. Whether you've ever been here or not, each one of these lessons is standalone. So if you can drop in for one, I welcome you to come and join us. Also, we are still in search for search committee members. So if you are interested in being part of the search committee to find the new pastor, I recommend that you get a hold of Nancy Perry and let her know that consistory right now is gathering names. Also, we have agreed as a congregation to help out a national survey exploring the pandemic impact on congregations. This is the last week to fill out your surveys. There are paper copies, there's a QR code, there's links, so there's a bunch of ways that you can take the survey, and I hope you will take the time. It's only 10 to 15 minutes. And it's really easy to do. If you take a paper copy, just leave it on the secretary's desk and we will mail them in for you. Also, I will be here next week, Sunday, but after that, Tom and I will be on vacation for 2 weeks. The following Sunday is the first Sunday in Advent, and Pastor David Lohr will be once again gracing our pulpit, so that's exciting. And then the following week, we will be having our children's pageant. And then I will be back the next Sunday after that. Also, on the 30th of the month, Saturday, we will be decorating the church at 10 right here. All are invited. There's a sign up in the back. And then we'll also, at 1 to 3:30, be having our family Advent celebration. So you can drop your kids off. You can stay with your kids. Grandparents, you can bring your kids. If you are going to drop your kids off for this very fun event, we ask that you get a permission slip and fill it out for us, please. Let's see. Advent is then approaching. The first Sunday of Advent is December 1st, and there are devotionals to guide you on your journey. There's also going to be a link in the newsletter that you can get them online, and there will be a daily post on Facebook. Are there any other announcements for the good of the group? Okay. I was going to say, that the only other announcement I have is today is Bob McCall's birthday. So as is our habit, when it's someone's birthday on Sunday, we all sing. So I hope you will join me in singing happy birthday to Bob. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Bob. Happy birthday to you. All right. Let's now take a moment to transition into our worship time. And we do that each week by intentionally slowing down and inviting God into our lives. As we pray, we inhale the presence and love of God, breathing in His goodness and light, and then we exhale the weight of our fears and our anxieties, handing to God all of those worries and wants. So let's begin. We put our right hand on our hearts and our left hand on our bellies, and then let's just slow down and take a breath in to the count of four through our nose. And then letting it go, blowing it out through our mouth to the count of more than four. Let's take another deep breath in, breathing in God's love and God's light. And then let's breathe out, letting go of any cares or worries we have. One more breath in. And then out. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, in times of chaos and uncertainty, we turn to you. Amidst the noise of the world, help us to hear your voice. Guide us through the uncertain times that lie ahead. May your peace and love fill our hearts, now and always. Amen. All right, let's turn our hearts to God as we bring in the light of Christ and we listen to our prelude.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. We gather together to worship, knowing that God is already here among us, knowing that there is nothing that separates us from the presence of our Lord. We gather together to worship, knowing wherever we are, wherever we go, God is near. We gather with confidence and hope, knowing that God is already with us. He stands eager to meet us and bless us with his love.
Seated.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. We have to admit, holy listener, that we are more likely to be irritated by the lives of others rather than being provoked to love them. When we are called to encourage those around us, too often our actions and words discourage them. Offered lives of peace and hope, we wander around filled with anxiety and despair. Forgive us, Rock of Redemption. Cleanse our hearts so we might be more loving. Keep us on the path of faithfulness so we might find those whom we are called to serve. Give us your words so we might confess your hope, offered to all who are broken, who are lost, who cry out to you. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
This is the good news, that even in our darkest hours, God is with us, giving us strength, giving us courage, and loving us through each and every moment. Thanks be to our Lord. Amen. may be seated. Now I'm going to ask the children to come forward. And I'm going to ask you to sit over here on the bench. I've got some pictures I want to show you in a few minutes. Come on. All right, cool. So when I show you the next couple of pictures, I want you to tell me if you think the picture you're looking at is old or new. Okay, and you guys can guess along. All right, let's look at the first picture. Old or new? Old. What do you think? Okay, you're right, but how can you tell it's old? Yeah, it's falling apart, huh? Yep, all right, let's look at the second picture. Old or new? Old, how can you tell? Because the shoes are falling apart, right. All right, one more. What do you think, old or new? Old, would you play soccer with that ball? No, why? Because it's falling apart, right? Yeah, all thanks for your help. You guys are all experts at telling whether something's really, really old or whether it's brand new. And one of the reasons you could tell was because those things were all falling apart, right? But in today's scripture lesson that we're going to learn about, we heard that one of Jesus' disciples forgot about that. In today's story, we hear that one of Jesus' followers was pretty excited about what a great building he thought the temple was. Jesus, though, told his disciple not to get too excited about it because at some point, he said, the temple was going to fall apart. Now, Jesus didn't say it just to be mean. Jesus knew that if the disciples only focused on things that fall apart, like shoes or cars or balls, and if most of those things started to fall apart all at the same time, then life could get pretty scary and pretty confusing. Which is why Jesus is teaching his disciples to pay attention to the one thing that doesn't ever fall apart. And what is the one thing that never falls apart? It's God. It's God. God never falls apart. Because then while everything else is falling apart, the disciples would be paying attention to God's wisdom. And that would help them to know the best thing to do, both for themselves and for everyone around them. And at the same time, Jesus was teaching the disciples in today's story, he's teaching us too. When things fall apart, Jesus reminds us that God is always, always, always with us. And he's there to help us to know what we should do right for ourselves and what we should do right for everyone else. And that's the good news for us today. So let's pray, shall we? Dear Lord, thank you for Jesus, who reminds us in a world where things don't last forever, you do. Thank you for sending your son to tell us that. Amen. We'll see you after church.
Our first letter is from Paul's letter to the Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 16 through 25. Listen as the Spirit speaks to the church. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. May God bless the reading of this holy word.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. This week, we are ending up with our last reading from the Gospel of Mark prior to Thanksgiving, and then after Thanksgiving, we will start into a brand new year of Advent. So let's finish up with chapter 13, verses 1 through 8. As Jesus was coming out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus said, "Ask him, do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nations will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines, but this is the beginning of birth pangs." This is the word for God's people. May God bless all who hear it and who keep it. Let's pray. Lord, be with us in these coming moments as we wrestle with your word today. Speak to our hearts and strengthen our wills so that we may follow you even more closely. Amen. Jesus said, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." So in our text today, Jesus is surely pointing to the imminent destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, which was the very heart center of Jewish faith and practice back then. You see, right then, things were starting to change quickly in Jerusalem, and in less than 30 years, the magnificent structures that made the Jews so proud, that held all their memories of the past and their dreams of the future as they saw it, would be laid to waste. But at that moment, you see, Jesus was pointing to even more than that. He was saying, you think the building is where God is? Well, what happens when the temple's gone? When it seems like your world is coming to an end? Where will your faith and your comfort be then? And it's a good question. It was a question for them, and it's a question for us. Because look, we all have temples. Our temples are things that we put our trust in. Things like our jobs, our marriages, our church, our country. And the walls are our beliefs and our dreams that keep these structures together, and they make us feel safe and help us to feel in control. And the studs of those walls, those are the sacred tenets that we hold dear. The ones that help us navigate and make sense of life in the world. Things like, thou shalt not kill, love thy neighbor, honor your vows. And when those walls start to shake, and when some of the studs even start to have cracks, that's when we become frightened and disoriented and angry. It happens in families. It happens in businesses and in societies at large. And I would venture to guess that every one of us here have felt our temple shake at one time or another. Just 2 weeks ago, we honored our saints who left us this year. And some of us have recently lost loved ones close to our hearts. Some of those losses were expected, and some were not. All leaving those they loved, living with this sense of before and after, like they'd never known. And yes, for each and all of them, the world felt like it was coming to an end on that certain day. Has that ever happened to any of you? An event that crashes into your life like a meteor, and nothing is ever the same? I remember how I felt after the death of my mom. I said it was like a kid being twirled around playing pin the tail on the donkey, blind and disoriented, just groping around to get my bearings back on life. Now, I know, of course, that the ending that Jesus points to with the temple today is a cosmic one, a final one, and an only one, I suppose. And yet it seems as though from the start of human existence, there have been wars and rumors of wars, nations rising against nations and kingdoms against kingdoms. Once again this week, we hear of terrorism and the threat of escalating wars, and yes, famine. And there's, in addition to famine, this sort of hunger where the poorest among us are forced to choose between paying the rent and putting a meal on the table right here in Doylestown. We see evidence of that every day at our blessing box. So these words, they roll around for us to ponder again and again and again. And clearly, with all this struggle, the end is still not here yet. And yet, we're still here, and God still waits and loves us. God waits for us to cry out together and for each other. God wants us to bring our real hurts, our real challenges, our real pains right here to Him in worship. God wants us to include Him in all the things that are of paramount importance in our world. He wants and needs us to be, He wants to and needs to be part of our deepest challenges. Because if we don't acknowledge our brokenness, God can't enter in and begin the process of our healing. God brought Jesus right into the messiness of life. And where polite society didn't have room for Him, He slept in a barn. And the Apostles' Creed tells us that Jesus was crucified, died, and was buried, and descended into hell. And they wrote these words precisely to remind us that there is nowhere that God won't go to reach out and claim us as His own. Those who've experienced a 12-step program know that we can't heal until we name our pain. And so we must acknowledge today that so many of us here have told me that we are grieving and shaken to the core by the recent election. And yet others of us here have said they are finally sighing a deep sigh of relief that after 4 long years, they can finally breathe again. Throughout this long election, both sides have been desperately afraid of the temple walls that hold their vision of America starting to crumble. And fear's taken hold. And for some, perhaps all of us, the walls of our temples, that is, the ideals, the beliefs, the dreams that we hold about ourselves, about our neighbors, about our church, about our country, and about our place in it has indeed been shaken to the core. But with all of that shaking, many false illusions have also fallen away. And maybe that's a good thing, because it causes each of us to dig a little deeper into who we are, who God is, where God is, and what really matters. This busy week, I opened a book by one of my favorite authors, Sister Joan Chittister, where she reflects on what is probably the most familiar words of Ecclesiastes: for everything there's a season. As this week carried so much pain for so many, I intentionally turned to her reflection on a time to weep. There she speaks the truth that we find it hard to acknowledge the need for times of weeping, because those times are always unwelcome. We don't like them. Chittister in her book speaks of how our individual tears can open our hearts to the pain of the entire world, and how in that way, God changes us. Yes, such trouble can be the beginning of birth pangs. Yes, by God's power, even by our tears, it can be the beginning of new life. No, indeed, for all our own effort and will, we won't get the wars, the earthquake, or the hunger to stop. These will still be. And yes, we will still be those who weep in the wake of those, perhaps most especially those things that affect our own lives and the lives of those we love. But at the same time, you and I are called to be among those who recognize that new life comes from even these places. The author of the letter of Hebrews reminds us that we are to encourage one another, waiting patiently through one another's tears, and then becoming midwives who help to birth new life into a hurting world that awakes. May with God's help, we all make it so. And all God's people said.
You know, as we begin to think about goals and dreams, given my circumstances, born in an abandoned building on a floor, being adopted, being labeled educable mentally retarded, failing twice in school, no college training, never worked for a major corporation, to believe that I had something of value. Have you ever thought about something you wanted to do and you talk yourself out of it? It's very important to realize that I found that most people fail in life not because they aim too high and miss. Most people fail in life because they did just like I did for so many years. They aim too low and hit. They didn't believe in themselves. So I want you right now to revisit and look at your goals and dreams, and let's raise the bar. And I want you to say with me, it's possible. It's possible. It's possible. I can do this. I can make this happen. No matter how bad it is or how bad it gets, I'm going to make it. It's possible. Yes, your dream is possible. Say that to yourself every day. Feed your mind with words that you write and words that you hear and words that you speak to yourself. Feed your faith, and your doubts will starve to death. Say to yourself, it's possible. It's possible. It's possible. Even when you have no evidence to point to, say to yourself, it's possible. There's nothing as powerful as a made-up mind. It's a struggle sometimes to do that, especially when you have people around you telling you that it's not possible, that you can't do it. And they're constantly pointing out your failures of the past, constantly reminding you of all of the things that you don't have going for you. I'm reminded of the story of the two little boys that were playing on some ice during the winter. And as they got further out on this ice, one fell through the thin ice. And so the little fellow that was still on top of the ice, he was trying to save his little buddy. And he couldn't reach him. He was trying to pull him. He could see him through the thin ice as he got further away from him, struggling. And he couldn't reach him. And he was trying to break the ice, and he couldn't do it. And he looked around, and he saw a tree in the distance, and he ran. And then he got up on the tree, and he pulled and broke down an enormous-sized branch and came back and savagely began to beat that ice and broke it. And miraculously, he saved his friend. And when the paramedics came, and they were able to revive this little boy, they were scratching their heads. They're trying to figure this out. Said, how could this little pruny fellow go up in a tree and break off a branch this size and then come back and beat and break the ice and save his friend? They thought it was just miraculous. It was baffling. And an old guy who was there said, I can tell you how he did it. And they said, how? How did he do it? And he said, there was no one here to tell him that he couldn't do it.
Our offering is a statement. By offering our treasure to God, we believe that we do here in this church does make a difference in this world, and that by this offering, we will hasten the day when the lame shall leap for joy, the blind shall see, and that scarcity and deprivation will exist only in our memories. Our morning offering will now be received. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. We return a portion of what we have received from you, O God, in gratitude for all that you have bestowed upon us. Bless this offering. Grant that it may continue to sustain and support the ministries of this church, to bring the light of Christ into this community and the world beyond. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us pray. We are glad and rejoice forever in you, O God. With joy, we draw deeply from your well of recovery and pray that even as we have sung, you may fulfill our story, the story of your love. Though the world has been gripped by trouble since early days and life has often been short and tormented, you have given us a vision. A day that's beyond terrors, a day when the heavens and the earth will be new again, a day when the sound of weeping will give way to delight, a time when all creation will live in peace and all people will long enjoy the fruits of their labors. Help us to hold on to that vision when the temples around us seem to be falling and our world is shaken. Strengthen us for telling of your truth and for keeping your path, that we might not weary in doing what is right, but through endurance may gain our souls, as you desire for each of us to do. Lord, in your mercy. As we pray for a new heaven and a new earth, we especially are aware of those among us and those beyond our doors who are in deep need of your peace, of your healing touch, and of your just and bounteous kingdom. Today, we lift up Wendy B., Tim Fuller, Bev Sedlock, David and family. Lord, in your mercy. We remember Sue, Alexa and family, David and Dorothy, and Dave Mitchell. Lord, in your mercy. We remember in prayer Dave Scott, Bud Warren, Lucy Rich, Ernie, Diane, and Mark. Lord, in your mercy. We lift the Dan Morehouse family, the Keith family, Sherry, and Barb. Lord, in your mercy. We remember Paul Cordray, Jean Grigalunas, Betsy Rollins, and Roger. Lord, in your mercy. And we remember Irv and Jerry, Lisa Christian, Bruce, and Jeff. Lord, in your mercy. We pray to you now silently as one family and lift our prayers to you this moment. Even as your Son taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or spirit and join me in our closing hymn, How Firm a Foundation, verses 1 through 3. What endures is not the edifice we build, but the work of God that we accomplish through our ministries in the name of Christ Jesus. Let us go forth from here empowered by the Holy Spirit to be God's instrument of justice, rooted in love to further the work of Jesus and to move us closer to God's reign of peace. Let us go in peace. Amen.